The divine is one, but he manifests himself on many planes, in many aspects, in many ways. And that's what creates confusion in the mind of a seeker or somebody who wants to dabble with philosophy. In philosophies, it's very difficult to comprehend. The one who is simultaneously the many and expresses himself at many planes of his own being. That's why when somebody asked Sri Raman Maharishi that Sri Aurobindo speaks about descent, so what does it mean? So his answer was that, well, I don't know what it means, because the divine is everywhere. So what does it mean by descent? Where will he come from? So that's one experience of the divine. Valid experience, but not the complete experience. When Sri Aurobindo was asked about it, there was this famous disciples who were doing back and forth, connecting Sri Aurobindo. He said, of course the divine is one, but he manifests himself at many levels in many ways. So when it is said that the descent, it is from one status of the divine to another, into the earth nature. To put it in one way, the divine is one. Ultimately, in his highest poise, is the unknowable, supreme. The mystery which can only be described as not this, not that, not this, not this, not this. Any definition would be a travesty of truth. But that is something with which maybe a certain class of seekers may have something to do with it. But for the sake of world, for the sake of manifestation, he shadows forth from himself the transcendent Sachidananda. That is the being of the divine. So, Sachidananda is beyond creation and he is there in his inalienable purity, in his inviolable ecstasy, in his immutability, eternity, all that. Then, from within him, there is the stir of creation, then he manifests as Anandamay, Leelamay. The stir of creation has begun. But for that, out of Sachidanand, the Parmeshwara and Parmeshwari, it is the Divine Mother, who is the consciousness force of the Supreme, who is lying in the eternal hush of Parabrahman. From there she comes out and Ananda begins to stir with the movement of creation. That's where we have our everyday connection with. Of course, Sachidananda is everywhere. There is nowhere where he is not. But always he is transcendent. Through any of the planes, layers, levels, we can plunge into that. Every night we are supposed to be touching something of that core and coming back to life again. This stir in Anandamay, the first stir of creation, enters into the supramental truth consciousness. That is also transcendent. So when we use the word transcendent, it means many things together. The Anandamay is transcendent because it is beyond the cosmos. The supramental is transcendent. It's also beyond cosmos. But in the transcendent, that stir of creation is now roasted. The seeds of creations are roasted in the fire. It is also regarded, supermind is regarded as the original home of the fire. The fire that has built the worlds. So that's where the divine manifests as the omniscient, omnipotent, truth conscious creator. As the creator, the supermind as creator. Imaged as the sun. And there these seeds begin to sprout, first into eternal worlds of eternal manifestation. No problem with those worlds, wonderful. But then he launches himself, if we may use a human language, into an extreme experiment. Why? Because something else must happen, something which is really on the brink of the last danger, so that the ultimate sprouting can take place. That's not possible. Something which seems to be just the very opposite of what he is. So, there is a ground which is created. He starts, the supermind enters into the overmind poise. From there he expresses himself as the cosmic divine. So, this cosmic divine has two kinds of powers, knowledge and ignorance, vidya and avidya. He uses both. Within us they are divided. But as far as he is concerned, both are his. He has to use both for the sake of evolution. So vidya is when in the overmind gnosis there is knowledge of the oneness, but it is in the background. And in the avidya, it is now turning towards creation, forgetting the oneness. That is the main difference. So forgetting of oneness means entering into ignorance. So from there, it layers after layers on each plane, he expresses himself as the adhishtata of each plane, as the godhead of each plane. It's beautifully described in Das Mahavidyas in the Upanishad. It's about the divine mother, that she is Tripur Sundari on the highest plane. She becomes the very opposite. Dhumavati in the lowest. She is all dark. She is Uma Hemvati, the fair one, in the highest. She turns into Kali, Kali Karali, Bhishan, the Asuri, the Rakshasi. All these are forms the one takes. So depending on the plane, till finally he enters into the inconscient. And then the evolution starts, of which we are a part, and you know, we weep and laugh, we we feel happy, we feel sorrow, all this mixture. And through all this it is taking place. But it doesn't mean that he has left us to our own resources. Not only as a cosmic divine, as the immanent divine, he dwells in the heart of each creature. It's not that he has abandoned and said, okay, fine, let it happen when it happens. Not only that, to give special propulsions towards that ultimate fulfillment, he also comes down as the avatar. And that's why I often feel there are two, three things without which any metaphysical understanding of Sri Aurobindo's yoga is totally incomplete. Because often I see these efforts to bring Sri Aurobindo's yoga to public, but these are crucial things which are missing. We are afraid of speaking of them, secular and intellectual. One of them is the avatar. There is a great emphasis of Sri Aurobindo on avatarhood. That's how divine mother. Without, second is without divine mother, there is no way one can practice this yoga, whatever we may say. Third is the psychic being. It's a very crucial point. Without discovery of the psychic being, there is no yoga. It is the beginning, the first real step in the real sense. All else is like seeking here, there, but this is the first radiant step. So he comes as avatar from time to time, age to age, yuge yuge, and carries it further. How many yugas? Well, astronomical figure, there are 14 cycles of Chatur Yugas according to Indian scriptures. We are in the seventh. Each Chatur Yuga is presided by one of the Manus, child of Brahma. This Yuga is presided by Shraddhavan Manu. Faith is the deity. And well, for the gods above, this is not a problem. Because if you really calculate, Brahma's one day, not night. Night is separate. 12 hours, to be precise. Brahma's one day is equal to 4.32 billion years on earth. So if Brahma says, don't worry my child, your struggle is only for a day. Only for an hour. You know what it means? Sir, aap to baithe ho, you are fine there. You know what we are going to go through for a couple of million years. Oh, there's nothing. So this is the big problem. You know, up there, it is nothing. It's a small fraction of time seen from that perspective. But seen from our perspective, Mother says at one place, we are constantly harassed because of the short lifespan. And we cannot see the whole continuity of life. We have to take it on faith. Unless we discovered the psychic being, then we know that we have been and we will be. But till then, we are constantly harassed. Oh, few more years, just a few more decades. Brahmaji is fine. You know, you tell that there is a struggle. So he says, you know, yeah, just a second in eternity. Beyond that, the eternal himself. But thankfully, we have the avatars who come down and carry our message all the way right there and do what is needed to give it a crucial boost. So, avatars are like boosters of evolution. They give leap, thousands of years of leap. And that's what the Divine Mother is. She has come to give creation a leap. Where has she come from? She has come from far beyond. Supermind, she has come to establish, but she's not coming from supermind. That's a station she has assumed for the present creation. But she comes from the original hush. Even the being of Sachidanand comes out because of her. That is her glory. And here she is having a beautiful dialogue with the Leela Mein, Anand Mein. She is the one who has, the star has gone from there for creation. And she is pleading our cause for a new creation. Because this earth is, you know, one can recall the dialogue between Ashupati and the Divine Mother in the vision and the boon. Something along similar lines. So we are on page 688, but thanks for someone who pointed out that I missed out four lines on page 686. So for the sake of perfect perfection, we must read it. Thank you for that. And these lines, four lines we missed out was, when she says, I too have wandered in star-jeweled grooves, that we had read when the Divine Mother is, as Savitri, incarnate divine, is sharing her concerns. Paced, this on page 686, somewhere in the middle. Paced sun-gold pastures and moon-silver sward. So sun is always the symbol of supermind and the worlds which are right in its proximity. And moon-gold. So it is very interesting. So moon is always the symbol of the spiritual mind. So if it is moon silver, silver is spiritual, gold is supramental. That's how the whole thing works. And heard the harping laughter of their streams and lingered under branches dropping myrrh. So myrrh, as the mother has said, you know, when we have the story of the Magis who came, who recognized in Christ the avatar, they didn't use this word, doesn't matter. But they recognized there is the divine who has come with a new light upon earth. And they gave him three things, gold, frankincense and myrrh. So gold is spiritual and material wealth. And frankincense is, of course, purity. And myrrh is immortality. So they gave to give this bit. So she says, I have been in that world where there is a rain of immortality, immortalizing rain. If you see myrrh, I mean, the myrrh extract is also used. But there is the immortalizing rain. That's where I have been. Because earlier there is a word called mist. So I think these were the four lines. Right. Now we come back to page 688 from the break. Two lines from above. Then with a smile august as noonday heavens, the Godhead of the vision wonderful. So she is now once more. Because he has to see, she is the one who is actually reporting things from below as the avatar, as the embodied divine. So he must caution her what's happening at ground level in his own vision. He has already made the plan. There is no doubt about that part. But is it now that is the whole thing being discussed? How shall earth nature and man's nature rise to the celestial levels, yet earth abide? It's a whole hierarchy which has been created. It will disturb the whole thing. Earth will no more be earth. But earth is a stepping stone towards higher world. So if there is no more earth, then the whole link is broken. So what happens to the beings in the subconscious and further down? Earth is a pedestal through which they move up. So is it possible? Have you seen? It's almost like asking, okay, you have been on earth. Do you think it is possible that heavenly lights can come down and earth nature will stay? It is not going to melt, dissolve, break apart. So it's a very, it's a nice question. It's not that he's saying, I don't know or you don't know. It's not that. She is the one who is the embodied divine. She's asking, will it happen? Is it possible? And then he goes further. Heaven and earth towards each other gaze across a gulf that few can cross. None touch, arriving through a vague ethereal mist, out of which all things form that move in space, the shore that all can see but never reach. So he says, you see, creation is from that formless state. It first comes as ether, the mist of ether, and then it concretizes into earth. Now, you see, it's a very interesting simile. It's like you stand on one side of the ocean and you want to see the other shore. And there is clouds and mist. You can't see. You know there is a shore out there, but you can't see. He says, that's the situation of man. Gods are in heaven, you can't see. Equally, God see the earth from far. They do, sometimes probably they do, tata bye-bye. But you know, we don't get to know what's happening out there. So we have, unfortunately, it is filled with imagination on various television in the form of, I mean, they are not like that, the way it is portrayed. But they can stare, but they cannot touch, like two shores. Heaven's light visits sometimes the mind of earth. Mind is little closer, body is far. Sometimes human mind stretches itself and can be touched by these higher lights. Its thoughts burn inner sky like lonely stars, few and far between. Time to time, somebody's mind is touched by that light and there is bursting out of a lonely star in the firmament of earth. Inner heart there moves celestial seekings, soft and beautiful like fluttering wings of birds. Celestial seeking, soft. They suddenly, there is a moment one is lost in a reverie and says, ah, I wish this beauty was manifested here. And the next moment there is something else and the mind has gone there and like fluttering wings. Where was that lovely bird? It's gone. Come, come, see, there is a lovely bird out there. So by the time somebody comes, the bird is flown away. So that's how celestial seekings visit our heart only for a brief while and then they go away. Visions of joy that she can never win traverse the fading mirror of her dreams. Visions of joy. You know, ah, my child, he will be a hero, a sage or whatever else. As he grows, starts with complaints from the school and then on and off. He says, okay. Visions of joy. Sometimes even otherwise we experience visitations of joy. Our heart is filled with some kind of a supernal joy. It has nothing to do with any of the earthly things. But only for a moment. If it goes beyond a point, then it melts into water and flows through the ears. Earthly vessel is too small, it cannot contain. Or we begin to jump and dance and throw it away, waste it. Because that's how human nature is, you know. Visions of joy traverse the fading mirror of her dreams. Faint seeds of light and bliss bear sorrowful flowers. See, even beings who came to rescue this world, the great ones, the vibhutis. See, I mean, often when it comes to sorrowful flowers, great sorrows, how they can strike even these great ones. Look at Guru Gobind Singh, a being of sacrifice coming right from the lineage of great yogis and seers. And he is died by deceit and he is killed in deceit, in a deceitful manner. So, seed of light and bliss. But what happens toward the end? Because of the, it's not about Papa and Punya, it's about the earth nature. It is unable to contain it. Something will happen. Earth is full of all kinds of forces. They are at play. And the divine plays it in grim earnest. It's not a puppet game. That's why once someone asked Sri Aurobindo about absolute protection. He said at this point of time, it is impossible to grant absolute unconditional protection. And can you imagine why? Because somebody was wearing a chain, gold chain, which got stolen from within the ashram precincts. So said, are, how can it be possible? And he had to say, that's where everywhere these forces, you can't just, you know, earth is not yet secure. He wants to make it secure. The supramental is there to make it secure. That's why when 1947, one time when Sri Aurobindo was seen as becoming serious because he must have seen the earthly play. No, Mool Shankar who used to do a massage of Sri Aurobindo's limbs and there was all this riot and all this going on. And he was curious and that's why they would very often say, don't rush into all this excitement. People go into, when they have taken to yoga, they plunge themselves into all this activism and all is very dangerous. And he rushed to see what's happening. all kinds of news were coming, and he was stabbed in the riot. And he died, and his body was brought all the way. So these things are real. Abhimanyu's death is real event. It's not a joke. It's not a fake. Because on earth, there is a play of forces. So many things we read in Sri Krishna's life, even toward the end. So earthly field cannot contain seeds of light and bliss. If you read the Bhagavat and read what happened to Sri Krishna's wives, it's a sad and sorry tale toward the end. Except for few who went away to the forest and nobody knows, nothing is written after that. So this is because earth nature is like this. It's not only about one and another. Look at Rama and Sita, how beautifully the story starts. They fall in love in the garden of King Janak, looking at each other. And Sita ji, Mata, asks to Mother Parvati that if there is someone whom I ask ever, it is him whom I have just had a glimpse of, Lord Rama. And as a blessing, a flower drops into her lap. Beautifully described by Tulsidas. That flower dropped and she knew ki she has granted it. But what better love there can be? But look at the life, sorrowful fruits. So that's the way even the divine beings have to go through. Faint harmonies caught from a half-heard song. Fail swooning mid the wandering voices jar. Foam from the tossing luminous seas where dwells the beautiful and far delight of gods. Sheer Sagar. Foam from that. And that's enough to make us, you know, feel strong and happy. But it's a foam. It won't last for long. The beautiful and far delight of gods. Raptures unknown. A miracled happiness. Thrill her and pass half-shaped to mind and sense. Deep within something is touched by the touch of beauty upon our lives. But as it passes into the mind and sense half-formed, it changes into something totally different. After a while, it evaporates. Above her little finite steps, she feels careless of naught or pause. Worlds which weave out a strange perfection beyond law and rule. A universe of self-found felicity. An inexpressible rhythm of timeless hearts. But there is within earth a seeking. Why? Because she feels somewhere there is a perfect state. And Sri Aurobindo says it very beautifully in the human cycle. The divine perfection is always above. But to express it in life, that is the real sense of yoga. All else is merely an imposture. It is always there above, divine perfection. That's why the mother says, our aim is not to lose ourselves into the divine consciousness, but to make life perfect with the divine perfection. And because of that, we feel the stir of idealism. Idealism is a shadow. In ignorance, the human mind conjures an ideal state. But the real truth is there. It's just a shadow following. It's a kind of image, like that puppet, images. We see an image, we think that's it. But it is there because deep within or high above, there is a home of perfection, and somewhere earth is aware of that. You know, people have written songs like that. Aa chal ke tujhe main leke chalun ek aise gangan ke chale. Come, let's go to the land where there is no sorrow, no grief. Because somewhere they felt, it's not that the writer was living in that state. After writing it, probably he was looking for his check. But during that moment, he was inspired. So that's how it goes. The many movemented heartbeats of the one. There is a state in which the one and the many are together as the Maharas in Vrindavan. There are no conflicts, no disharmony. All are together, experiencing the same rapture. All the gopis and gops are dancing with the one Krishna. They are not having any jealousies. But when they start dancing here, one says, oh, I think Krishna is giving more attention to Chandrabala. Sri Aurobindo's famous aphorism. Mother is closer to this person Maybe she is closer to that. She smiled a little longer. She touched this person. He was allowed to stand before her for a longer time. This person she has kept close in her service. Oh, she is closer to that person. Then next is, she doesn't love me. So this is here. There, she loves all of us. And there is no jealousy, no imbalance, no disharmony. So that's a state we aspire for, but it doesn't last for long. Magic of the boundless harmonies of self. Order of the freedom of the infinite, the wonder plastics of the absolute. You know, these harmonies of the infinite. And so if you ask Krishna, hearing his flute, sir, please tell me which raga is it? What will he say? He say, every moment it's a different thing. No, sir, there must be a way of capturing it. Try it. So Sri Krishna has come, sung his flute and gone. Then some people gather and they start creating ragas. And based on that ragas, we have several people now using the flute. But that is not the flute of Sri Krishna. It is free. It is infinite. You can't capture it by any combination. That's why I keep saying not to try to, you know, reduce Savitri to it is this meter or that meter. What does the human mind know? It is a lexicon, as Shivinda has used in Savitri, lexicon of the infinite mind. It is the flutings of the infinite. We may try to do it by stretching our mind, but let's enjoy the delight and freedom of the infinite. So he's using the word order. See the paradox. Can there be an order when there is freedom and infinity? So he says, yes, order of the freedom of the infinite. This is Satya Dharma in the real sense. So Satya Dharma is not something rigid and fixed. That's why when people talk about, you know, Dharma, what should be done or not to be done. So we have rules, codes of conduct, this, not this. Mother says this, mother says that. She said, don't use my name. But in the divine, it's an unfolding. At this point, the truth unfolds in this way. In another moment, it's a completely different thing. There is an order. In the sense, this is Ritchit. It's governed by truth. But it cannot be reduced to any human law or formula of ethics or code of conduct or a legal this thing. It's bound to fail because it's based on the unfolding of truth. Very difficult for the human mind to conceive, but it is possible to live it. If we get connected, that's why Yajnavalkya says, you know, Satya Dharmai Drishte, I want to know that law of truth. So much later it becomes Manu Smriti, to put it that way. But in its origin, it is not Manu Smriti. Manu is the one who in the mind receives that truth and turns it into various kinds of dogmas. These two changes. Manu Smriti of the previous yuga has no relevance here. So Manu Smriti is a much later second-hand version of something which is much, much higher and deeper and cannot be fixed into any rigid dogma. The wonder plastics of the absolute. Absolute. Absolute, by that we understand what I say is absolute. So something fixed. But absolute is not fixed. Wonder plastic. It is fixed only in one sense, and that is truth. It expresses truth in whatever way, whichever way. When Sri Krishna goes to plead his case on behalf of the Pandavas for peace, it is truth. When Sri Krishna orders Arjuna, Uttishtata Jagrata, of course that's from the Upanishad. But something similar. Parth, wake up, fight the great battle. That is also Sri Krishna. So we can't reduce him into that. So there is a both are absolute, but look at the wonder plastic. Is it the same Krishna who few days back was telling, give just 5 villages and they will not fight? He could have even cancelled that waiver. After all, saving human beings is so important. Maybe if they didn't give 5 villages, he could have said, come, all of us will live in Vidura's place, or I have Dwarka, why don't you come and stay there? No. The next moment, the command is fight and slay the enemy. So it's wonder plastics of the absolute. When mother was asked, somebody told mother, you know, I have completely surrendered myself to the divine. I am ready to do whatever he will say. Except for slaying, which I know he will never ask me to kill anybody. And mother asked him, how do you know that? How do you know that? The divine is divine. So we can't fix him into a mental formula. This is not to say that every killing, oh, I am being moved by this God. No, there is no way you can turn it into a fixed formula. That is what is being expressed here. There is the all truth and there the timeless bliss. But hers are fragments of a star lost gleam. On earth what we get? Some stars that have died thousands of years back. We are receiving the gleam today because light takes that much time to travel. So you say, lovely star. For all we know, that star has already died. We are receiving the gleam. So star lost gleam, that's what earth receives. Hers are but careless visits of the gods. They come for a while and what is left behind is stories and name. Splendid names. And that's all is left. They are a light that fails, a word soon hushed, and nothing they mean can stay for long on earth. There are high glimpses, not the lasting sight. So he's making Savitri aware of the enormity of the difficulty. Even if you create an overmind creation, see, this is something very similar to mother's experience when she had made an overmind creation where people were experiencing the birth of the great gods within themselves. Amrita was experiencing the consciousness of Brahma within him, of Varuna, Nalnida, like that. And they used to get such marvelous experiences. So she went to Sri Aurobindo and she was so happy that, you know, here is a creation. Sri Aurobindo says, yes, this is wonderful. We can make a very great religion out of it, the greatest which has ever been on earth. But there will still be the possibility of ignorance and eventual collapse. This is not what we want. We want nothing short of the perfect perfection of the supramental. And she says, in my inner consciousness, I knew within 2 hours she wiped away that entire creation. And then she says, now back to work. So everybody wondered what happened. We had such, so people often describe it as the golden period. No, that's not the golden period of the ashram life. That was the silver gold period. Silver mixed with gold. The gold is yet to come, the khati gold, 24 karat gold. And that will happen when this world becomes her ashram. That's the age we are living in. If you can climb to an unperishing sun or live on the edges of the mystic moon, so mystic moon is again the spiritual mind, on the heights of that spiritual mind from where they can glimpse the supramental light. And channel to earth mind the wizard ray. There are few who have risen to that height and receive that light from beyond and express it upon earth. I mean, we have some great creations, we know. Virgil and Homer and our own Valmiki, Vyasa and the great poets, Kalidas and many others who have received that, Dante, and they have expressed. That's a very rare thing. The heroes and demigods are few to whom the close immortal voices speak, and to their acts the heavenly clan are near. We see that whole age when the Mughal Empire was at its peak and it had to be demolished. Suddenly there were Shivaji and that movie we saw, and Tanaji and all these people came. Bajirao, and they were heroes. They didn't care for their body's death. They knew they are immortal. Receiving the sword of Bhavani, he could challenge the whole Mughal Empire and demolish it. It never woke up. It could never rise after that. So he says that they are very few. They come from time to time and then they go away. But they are closer to the heavenly kind. They are not close to us. Their actions cannot be understood by earth. We can only worship them. Ah, great heroes. After that, Shivaji's own son and grandson lost that afflatus. Became like very ordinary people. Few are the silences in which truth is heard, unveiling the timeless utterance in her deeps. Few are the splendid moments of the seers. So it's not that seers are all the time having glorious visions. This is what, you know, often we think, oh, all the time everything he's seeing is truth. It's not like that. There are moments when deep in meditation, they see something beautiful or something like a light of intuition falls upon their mind and they utter something. It's like that. But it doesn't mean that they are through and through intuitivized. That's a big, tall order. So he says there are few moments in which that light is glimpsed. It is enough to create a prophet and a seer. And now comes these lines. So he's saying, therefore, Savitri, this is one part of the problem. Earth is not ready. Man is not ready. Heaven's call is rare. Rare are the heart that heeds. Don't want to say this, but this is a sad truth. God calls. There is an awakening. There is a call. But we put it off for little more problems. Let them get sorted out. When those problems get sorted out, there are some more problems. Children are sorted out, grandchildren. First person to be sorted out is husband. He doesn't allow me. He is the problem. So after some time, husband's mind changes. He says, you are free. Go wherever you want to. Oh, you are free. Come. My call is there. No, no. You know, my children, they are studying in college. You know how much I have to be there. They are giving. You know, I have never understood this. Children are giving exams, so mothers have to be around. They have to be around. Because why? Because they have to give something to eat and drink and all this. As if children in hostels never went through exams. I'm a hostel product, so I can tell you it's a great fun. But you know, mothers have to be around, handing over the child. Then, okay, child has grown up, but just marriage, sir. You know what it means. Okay, God says, get the child married. Ek pote ka muh dekh lo, dadi ban jaun, phir aa jaungi. You know what it means to be a grandmother on earth? I'm a great grandmother. You say, okay, now it's too late. You wait for becoming a child again. Maybe born to your own child who will say, she is my great grandchild, and then you will be happy. So this is how. Heaven's call is rare. It doesn't mean one has to run away from life and be elsewhere, but to follow that call within, to give oneself with commitment to that, even while being in everything in life. It's not about leaving life, abandoning it, coming somewhere. But just to follow that call, give it priority, give it importance. Try to weave life around it. Make it the center of our existence. The doors of light are sealed to common mind. So when people say that we don't understand Sri Aurobindo and the mother, it means this. It's not that Sri Aurobindo is difficult. It means the doors are sealed. Why they are sealed? They are sealed because traditional thought has come and put big locks of understanding. We want to understand Sri Aurobindo based on what is written in this scripture or that scripture. Though the scripture says, at least the Indian scripture says, go beyond the scripture. Shabd Brahmati Vartate. But that's very few can take that daring. So there is the. And then he goes further, and earth's needs nail to earth the human mass. So mother says that, you know, every time in my young age, people would say, oh, divine and all is everything, but you know, is fine. But you know, the problem, the challenges, the difficulties. So I thought that if I have the means, I will create a space where people don't have to worry about food and staying, and so that they can pursue the divine. So she says, somewhere around what can be regarded as the middle life of one's own existence, I had the means, and so the ashram was created, where all the things are provided, so that now you can give yourself completely to the pursuit of God. She says, but my experience tells me it is not this. Because everything is there, there is a tendency to become lazy. Because there is freedom, there is a tendency to become licentious. Freedom means I'll do anything, say anything, it's freedom. So she says, my own experience is that mankind needs blows. I have tried my best to provide a space where everything is there, but man is not ready. So that's why the blows are needed, which we see in the next few lines. Only in an uplifting hour of stress, men answer to the touch of greater things. for children before exams, for politicians before their election. Even the most avowed non-believer politician goes quietly, he will call the soothsayer and ask, will I win or not win? If he really spent that time in really improving his constituency, he would ensure that he'll win. But that they will not do for 5 years. Hour of uplifting stress. That's when we remember God. Or raised by some strong hand to breathe heaven air, they slide back to the mud from which they climbed. The touch of the divine he holds, catches us by the collar and says, come up. So initially, wow, divine is carrying us. After some time, Lord, it's a bit stifling, you know. My neck is getting hurt. Arre, stay. Sir, I can't breathe this air. Stay, sir. Actually, I left my mobile on the ground. Can I just go and pick it up? After that, you can keep me with you. So we slide back to the mud from which we climbed. In the mud of which they are made, whose law they know, they joy in safe return to a friendly base. This is the tragedy. That's why it is in a way all right when people have not turned to the divine, but when they have heard the call and turned, and then turned their, you know, backs upon it, what it means. It's a real tragedy. If you look at it like this. So after some time, they slide back into the mud, and then what do? They say, ah, familiar people, familiar faces. So they are back to relatives, they are back to all, and they have left the absolute. It goes further, and though something in them weeps for glory lost and greatness murdered, they accept their fall. There can be no greater tragedy than this. Greatness murdered, the great possibility which somebody came. You know, there are some very interesting instances. One I remember, her name was Jyoti something in ashram long, long back. And then she got married. Mother didn't want her to. And she went away. A rich family. But 2 years down the line, the amount of suffering. And then she would want to come back and she could not come. And eventually died in a state of intense suffering. Of course, their suffering is now purification. But look at it, like, what an opportunity and what a loss. So there are real stories, there are quite a few, but let's not scare each other. But it's so that, you know, we should be more and more sincere about, there is no end to the sincerity which we can cultivate. So the greatest insincerity is to believe I am sincere. Everybody is insincere. I am sincere. But to remember always that there is something more we can do. The ahuti is not complete. There is more which we can give. There is always something to give. Something to give. Then we are on the track. It's not that in one day one grows. What is still worse is to be the common man they think the best. To live as others live is their delight. What is this common man? My child, you know, he is settled in USA. Whatever that means, God knows. Actually, it means nothing. But my, you know, very happy. Illusory happiness. He'll have the same issues, same problems, eventually same life, same happiness, sorrow, same departure. But there is an illusion. So there is all these things to be like a common man. It's not that people in USA are common. No. It's like we think along those lines that this is the ultimate. If the child is well settled, having a good career, got his very good job. So what do we say? Congratulations. Isn't it? Supposing the child said, actually, I don't want to take up this job and I want to go in pursuit of the divine. Psychiatrist. Isn't it? Something is wrong. This is not the age. He's going crazy. Please get him checked up. This is the problem. Problem is not as long as he's seeking and, you know, going through. But we give so much importance. This is the distortion of values. We value what has basically hardly any value. And we do not value what has the deepest intrinsic value. So this is what, to live as others live is their delight. For most are built on nature's early plan. Early plan of nature is not the conscious, aspiring, seeking man. Early plan is the primitive brood, the animal. Bhedchal, as it is called. Common man. Bhedchal. We must do whatever everybody is doing. If there is a WhatsApp circulating, we must believe it blindly. This is the Bhedchal. So in various ways, we just follow that. The human, for most are built on nature's early plan and owe small debt to a superior plane. But some come with the touch of something higher. They awaken to a greater life, like vibhutis. But most are built on nature's early plan. The human average is their level pitch, a thinking animal's material range. This is the early plan of God, nature. What is the early plan? Thought has come, but what is this thought doing to provide for the family, better job, better money, how to invest, where to invest, get more money? This is the early plan. Thinking animals, material range. Not the thinking conscious beings, higher flight and aspiration. That's not there in early plan. That comes later. So this is one part of the problem, that man is not ready. Same thing Ashupati is told when he stands at the doors of the tunnel. What thou hast won is thine, but ask no more. No soul is thy companion in the light. Alone thou standest at the eternal doors. No, you are carrying this aspiration on behalf of man. Man doesn't want it. Even if you go down in their midst, they don't want transformation, divinization. They will call it abstract. They will come ultimately and say, how you can help me when I have this problem or that problem. That's all they want. Then there is another problem which is also there. In the long, ever mounting hierarchy, in the stark economy of cosmic life, each creature to its appointed task and place is bound by his nature's form, his spirit's force. So nature has created like this. He's not blaming anyone that human beings are like this or like that. There's no condemnation, no blaming. He says this is how nature is created. Everybody is bound by their nature, swarupa, by their form, swarupa, by their nature, swabhava. Even the Gita says, you can break free from that by karma yoga, but your nature will be still bound to that. He says, how can you talk about changing it and making them grow into divinity? They are bound. This elephant, Lakshmi, every day you see, mighty creature. One day she realizes, I am divine. She can break free all the chains and throw away all the people who are making fool of her, getting selfies and photographs. But she doesn't, because she's bound by her own nature, which makes her feel the light in human eyes. Oh, this intelligence I must be scared of. She doesn't know that she has strength much greater than a human being. But she's bound. Similarly, human beings, we are bound by our own nature and swarupa and swabhava. But we are not here for this. But this is the old world paradigm. If this were easily disturbed, it would break the settled balance of created things. What it means is that the Divine Mother has to work not only on us, but also on cats and donkeys and rats and who knows what. Also on titans, also on the gods, because it's part of one chain. That's why she has to tell Durga, you see, learn the joy of surrender. Do you like it when people worship you? She says, no, I don't. Actually, I don't care. But what to do? People come and worship me. She has to do it. Why? Because otherwise, imagine, they are absolutes in their own right. And when this chain is disturbed and men will grow like gods, they won't be very happy. As such, they are not very happy that, you know, every time you see somebody's flame is rising up to heaven, Indra is very disturbed, his throne starts, this earthquake in heaven, heavenquake, sorry. And he sends a, you know, celestial damsel that, look, this fellow is climbing too high. Tell him to stay on earth with earthly things. That's why, because he's scared. So imagine if men grow as gods, what is going to happen? The titans, they will be scared. They will say that already gods were bad bargain for us. Now these human beings will also. So what it'll do? It will break the settled balance of created things. The perpetual order of the universe would tremble and a gap yawn in woven fate. So Vishnu, Lord Vishnu, who is woven, preserves the balance. It'll be a problem even for him, because there'll be a gap. Suddenly there are no human beings. There are apes and there are godlike divinized beings. So that won't be. It will be, human chain will remain. We should remember, it's not that suddenly one night everybody will wake up and say, like, let there be supramental world, and there was supramental world. There is a whole range of intermediate beings. If men were not and all were brilliant gods, the mediating sphere would then be lost, by which the spirit awake in matter winds. So this is the whole problem. You see, this mediating sphere is very interesting. How, when each one moves up, he helps the whole chain. It's very interesting. One can see it on the darshan day. You are standing on the staircase. You are ready to move, but the person in front of you wants to stay there. Supposing it doesn't move, what do you do? Something you have to do, because the whole chain is stuck. So he moves, and then we move. As he vacates the stair, so this is the cosmic order of things. Suddenly everybody, by some magic, goes there. There are no staircase, nothing. And people won't know how to reach up to that point. That itself has to be there. You know, this, I was reading this fellow, Akshay Kumar's house, when he bought the house, he's a fanatic about physical exercise. So in his house, he didn't have a staircase. It was on second floor. So when his friend came to meet him, film director, he said, come up. He said, but from where? He said, climb through the wall. So on the wall, there were some jutted out things he had to catch and climb. He said, every day I do this exercise. He says, for you, it's okay. How will others come? So there has to be a stairway through which we climb. That cannot be lost. The mediating sphere would then be lost, by which the spirit awake in matter winds, accepting the circuits of the middle way, by heavy toil and slow aeonic steps, reaching the bright miraculous fringe of God into the glory of the oversoul. I know there is a lot of things written on the word oversoul. There have been books written, but oversoul actually is a synonym used also for the spirit, the Brahman. This word first coined by Ralph Waldo Emerson. He is the one who wrote about the oversoul. And there's some magical lines he wrote. He didn't use the word vibhuti. I mean, he was not just a thinker, but a sage. So he writes about transcendentalism, the Vedantins of America. They're Vedantins. They didn't use the word. So he speaks about, when the oversoul breathes into the intellect, there is birth of genius. When the oversoul, replace it with spirit of Brahman, breathes into the will, there is a man of virtue. When the oversoul breathes into the heart, there is love. I mean, so beautifully. I mean, so he says that what is possible is to merge into that Brahman, or let that afflatus time to time breathe into your inner being. So slowly one can reach that point through heavy toil into the glory of the oversoul. And then the last part, the challenge. He says, my will, my call is there in men and things. This is the original mobile number, is 010101. Whether you call him Shunyam or you call him as one of the Advaitin. It's always there in every man. But the inconscient lies at the world's grey back. That call is muffled by the many voices and the noise of the inconscient. So we are not able to hear. And draws to its breast of night and death and sleep, imprisoned in its dark and dumb abyss, a little consciousness it lets escape. So it allows only a little bit to come. In between all that noise, you hear a little, there is something like an om, you tune. Then again this muffled voice. This is the original sense of the story of Brahma's five heads, and one was chanting the, you know, the Vedas in the wrong way, and Shiva turns back and removes the head. This is one of the stories about why Brahma eventually had four heads. So the whole, it's a very cryptic story about the inconscient and how the, because he's the creator word, and how the evolution has to be a slow process. unless by Shiva's intervention, one can just abruptly cut the chain. But let me not get into that story. Something more beautiful is here. But jealous of the growing light holds back, close to the obscure edges of its cave, as if a fond, ignorant mother kept her child tied to her apron strings of nescience. So we had two kinds of mothers. One mother, my child should stay in my village, in my house, near me. All right, you'll be happy. But the child will never really grow. He'll never face the challenge of life. The other is go, travel far. And then the child sees the world, this life, grows through that contact with the outside world. Then comes back as a free, organic individual. So that's why we have wandered so far and we have to travel this journey. But now the dark mother, inconscient, she says, no, 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 I love you. Maybe you stay here. Maybe the moment he speaks about that, I want to go, then the mother starts having some aches and pains in the leg, heart attack here, there, God knows, all the diseases in the world. If you go away, to hamari budhape mein kaun dekhbhal karega? Who will take care of me? As if the child was brought into the world to look after in old age. There can be no more selfish reason than this. But this is the reality. So Shobindu is saying, jealous of the light holds back. If the child starts having ideas which are beyond the traditional framework, no, 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 you must follow the traditions. Jealous of the light ties back to apron strings. So all these examples, see, Shobindu gives so beautifully, tied to her apron strings of nescience. The inconscient could not read without man's mind, the mystery of the world its sleep has made. Man is its key to unlock a conscious door, but still it holds him dangled in its grasp. It draws its giant circle round his thoughts. It shuts his heart to the supernal light. Inconscient itself could not understand itself but through the man's mind, but denies it to go further. Typical example is when a child has to, it came recently as an advertisement. A boy is all the time on mobile phone. And the father, typical father, beta, yes, dad, and busy. So he says, you know, for 2 days I am telling you that the bill has to be paid. What are you doing about it? And suddenly clicks a button and says, dad, ho gaya. Ho gaya? Mobile se ho gaya, Paytm se. Now, you know, the same thing which you use, you don't want it to also grow. Now, there are a lot of people against technology, internet and everything. But they use it when it comes to their own purposes for email and everything. But otherwise, technology is bad. So similarly here, that it could not read without man's mind itself. For all the issues, mom calls the beta, you know how to handle the mobile. Please do it for me. But otherwise, sara din mobile par laga rehta hai, you know. This is the age. This is how things are growing. Intense mental development. Yes, that's how. And one day one has to go beyond it. But that is the challenge of evolution, which right now, the Leela Maya is revealing to Savitri that, look, these are the issues which you are going to face. Are you ready? Is man ready? The answer is, man is not ready. Are you ready to do it? That's what now Savitri has to answer. That we'll read tomorrow, because today is only one session. Tomorrow we'll have two sessions and we'll continue from here.